Amen, amen. Praise the Lord, everybody. This is the day that the Lord has made. We ought to rejoice and be glad in it. Bible says, magnify the Lord with me. Let us exalt his name together. Let us stand all over God's house. Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Eternal God, our Father and our King, we thank you for allowing us to come together one more time. God, thank you for watching over us as we slept and slumbered on last night. Thank you for traveling mercies, God, as we were able to get in our modes of transportation and make it out to the house of Christ one more time. Lord, we thank you for being a protector and for being a provider. So now, God, as we go into this worship service, we ask that you to just have your will and to have your way. This is your house, and you are our shepherd, and we are the sheep of your pasture. God, we thank you in advance for what you're going to do. Holy Spirit, you are welcome in this place. Holy Spirit, you are welcome in this place. For those who are watching, for those who are listening, Holy Spirit, you are welcome in this place. Move as only you can move. Do what only you can do. And we'll be careful to give your name the praise, the honor, and the glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Worship, I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. Our feast shall stand within thy gates, O Jerusalem. Because of the house of the Lord our God, I will seek thy good. Blessed are they that dwell in thy house. Lord, I have loved thy habitation, the place where thy honor dwelleth. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. Amen. You may be seated. Let us do so this morning by joining in with our opening selection. And say it back to me. Say, Jesus.
Let us pray. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Ghost, we come, Father God, to lift this prayer to you. We come, Father God, in a oneness in the Spirit of Christ, in the name of Jesus.
In the name of Jesus.
Knowing that you are God and you are God all by yourself. There's no other God but you. And you are the God that is the creator. You are merciful. You are long-suffering. You are peaceful. You are love. You're full of grace. Father God, we come to thank you for your goodness, grace, and mercy towards us. But dear God, let us first ask you to forgive us for our sin that we have committed against your divine majesty by thought, word, and deed. So glad that you are faithful and just God to forgive us of our sins and to cleanse us of all unrighteousness. So I know, Father God, we have gathered here to worship. We want to lift up Jesus, God, that you may be glorified. Hearts are willing. So I know, dear God, we thank you for the move of your Holy Spirit. This is a sacred time now, church. We're going to take authority over any evil spirit, any evil thoughts that may seek to hinder this worship, and we bind it in the name of Jesus. We lift up the blood stained banner of Jesus and take authority.
Yes, God. Yes, God.
We thank you, Father God, and we praise you. Now, dear God, allow for your manservant, our pastor, to bring forth your word. Let him feed us with your goodness. And I pray that we eat and let it rest.
Yes,
and then let it come out of us in a mighty way. It's in Jesus' name we pray. We thank you and we love you, Lord. Amen.
I will trust in, that's old school, the Lord. I will trust, let me hear, in the Lord. Let me hear you say it. Come on, in the Lord. How long? Until I die. Let me say it. I will trust my
in the Lord.
Oh my.
I will trust.
Yeah.
In the Lord.
Oh.
I will trust.
Said, I know it's early this morning, but every said, I will trust. I don't hear you. Singing and making Georgia.
My.
I don't know y'all new school folk don't know this song. When I grew up, the old folk would say this. They say, I'm going to stay on the battlefield.
You just gotta go to war. Say, devil, you can't have my family. You can't have the blessings God has given me. You do know children are a blessing from the Lord. Amen. Amen. I think somewhere it said, may your quiver be full. Amen. Amen. Our scripture reading, Job chapter 1, verses 1 through 10. I'll be reading the NIV. Those who are able, please stand. Job chapter 1, verses 1 through 10. Book of Job, Old Testament reading, chapter 1, verses 1 through 10. So in the land of Uz, there lived a man whose name was Job. This man was blameless and upright. He feared God and shunned evil. He had 7 sons and 3 daughters, and he owned 7,000 sheep, 3,000 camels, 500 yoke of oxen, and 500 donkeys, and had a large number of servants. He was the greatest man among all the people in the east. His sons used to hold feasts in their homes on their birthdays, and they would invite their 3 sisters and to eat and to drink with them. When a period of fasting had run its course, Job would make arrangements for them to be purified. Early in the morning, he would sacrifice a burnt offering for them, for each of them, thinking, "Perhaps my children have sinned and cursed God in their hearts." This was Job's regular custom. One day the angels came to present themselves before the Lord, and Satan also came with them. The Lord said to Satan, "Where have you come from?" Satan answered the Lord, "From roaming throughout the earth, going back and forth on it." Then the Lord said to Satan, "Have you considered my servant Job? There is no one on earth like him. He is blameless and upright, and man that fears God and shuns evil. Does Job fear God for nothing?" Satan replied. "Have you not put a hedge around him and his household and everything he has? You have blessed the work of his hand so that his flock and his herds are spread throughout the land." May the Lord add a blessing to the hearing, reading, and understanding of his word. From all that dwells below the skies, let thy creator's praise arise. Let thy redeemer's name be sung through every land by every tongue. Summary of the Decalogue, hear what Christ our Savior said. Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, and with all thy mind. This is the first and great commandment, and the second is like unto it. Thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. On these 2 commandments hang all the law and the prophets. Therefore we say, glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now, and evermore shall be, world without end. Amen. And amen. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. We thank God for this opportunity to be a blessing unto him. It's giving time. Time for us to be a blessing back unto God as God has blessed us with. He said, bring your tithes into this storehouse where you are have room enough and meat to feed yourselves and to feed God's people. So we ask that those who are able will give from a loving heart. He said, God loves a cheerful giver. So as you give, give because God has given unto you. And we know there's several ways that we can give. We can give in person. You can drop it in the mail, 113 Sequel Street, Norfolk, Virginia, 23505. You can give online. Givelify, the New Mount Zion A.M.E. Church. You can give through Zelle. Look for Sister Loretta Hayes Riddick. Give as God has given unto you. And I declare he will bless you. Good measure. Pressed down, shaking together, and running over. Amen. Amen. Now we prepare for our message of the morning as we will have our sermonic selection.
Thank you.
anybody expecting God to do something? Any day now. God, I know you're able to do it. We praise God for his love and his kindness and his joy that he brings to his people. Just in case you guys didn't realize, NFL started Thursday night. This is the first Sunday of NFL season. And I didn't want anybody to have any questions about what team the pastor like. So I came on this Sunday just to let folk know. I know you got your team, but I just wanted to let folk know, you know, who the pastor's rooting for. I had a great college day. I mean, I've been riding some buffaloes and some bisons, Brother Dennis. I looked at Buddy's game, and they blew out Morehouse, and then I saw Dion, and Dion said he always going to bet on 21 black. That was his number that he wore, so I'm going to ride them Buffaloes until the Cowboys decide they want to do something. Amen, somebody. But we thank God for his joy, and we thank God for all that he does in the lives of his people. It's preaching time. Turn with me to Job, where the word in your hearing, we're just going to read verses 5 through 10, just a portion of that. It says, so it was when the days of fasting had run their course that Job would send and sanctify them. He's talking about his sons. He would rise early in the morning and offer burnt offerings according to the number of them all, his sons and daughters. For Job said, maybe it was that my sons have sinned and cursed God in their heart. And thus Job did regularly. Now there was a day when the sons of God came to present themselves before the Lord, and Satan also came among them. And the Lord said to Satan, from where did you come? And Satan answered the Lord and said, from going to and fro on the earth and walking backwards and forth on it. Then the Lord said to Satan, have you considered my servant Job? There is none like him on the earth, a blameless and upright man, one who fears God and shuns evil. So Satan answered the Lord and said, does Job fear God for nothing? Have you not made a hedge around him, around his household, and around all that he has on every side? You have blessed the work of his hands, and his possessions have increased in the land. But now stretch forth your hand and touch all that he has, and he will surely curse you to your face. Pray with me as we use for a subject this morning. Lord, be a fence. God, we thank you for this time. We thank you for this moment. We thank you for reminding us that sometimes we have to go to war. We thank you for reminding us that sometimes we got to stay on the battlefield. But in it all, we must trust in the Lord until we die. So God, we ask now that you would allow me to preach until the real preacher comes, the precious anointing of your Holy Spirit. Therefore, God, if I stand with any arrogance, God, humble me. But if thou find any fear in me, God, strengthen me. Remove me from me and use me for thee. We ask it all in the powerful and perfect name of Jesus the Christ, our kinsman redeemer. My dear friends, Denzel has a new movie coming out, The Equalizer 3, so they have been showing some of his other movies that have been coming out. And I realized that one of them was Training Day. The Magnificence of Denzel was to reemerge after that, and he became director, and he did a movie by Augustus Wilson, 1983 stage play called Fences. In the Broadway play, which I researched, it was a fence put right down the center of the stage. But in the movie, metaphorically, there are fences everywhere. The central character, whose name is Troy Mason, who is a former baseball player turned trash collector. His ability was caged by the times and that made black skin a liability. He does some time in prison, and by the time he is released, he's bitter, y'all. The life circumstances has made it difficult for him to have healthy relationships with his wife or his children. So without spoiling the end, y'all can go watch the movie if you want to. But just like this sanctuary can identify, people can identify what it means to have, to live behind a fence. A fence is nothing more than a structure that closes off an area. Some of y'all got y'all backyards fenced in. You don't need a movie or a play to show you that life is full of fences. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. You got limited access, the prohibited opportunities, blocked blessings, withholdings of what you have worked for, plywood fake friends, trapped emotions, and imprisoned to responsibilities. I say there's fences everywhere. So Troy in the film experiences a full range of feelings with a charismatic personality. He would be warm and charming one minute and a pit bull the next minute. Because that is how life is when you live behind a fence. Several years ago, I was in a prison talking to a warden, and he shared with me, he said, Pastor Ruff, you have to understand the dangers of being a correctional officer is that you have to deal with temperament. It's like a light switch. Being in bondage will put you on the bedside while you are standing up. Oh, help me somebody. There's a book I want to offer to you that's called Let Go of Unhappiness by Peter Mickelson. If you get a chance, buy that book and read it. If not, just check it out at the library. He says in his book that addiction is a self-defeating reaction to a consequence to an unresolved negative emotion. Let me say that again. Addiction is a self-defeating reaction to a consequence to an unresolved negative emotion. In simpler terms, an addiction is an unconscious way of coping with how you feel. Okay, and let's explore these emotions produce inner conflict. They can produce suffering and self-defeat. You wonder why so many are walking around here with low self-esteem. Sobriety can be a roller coaster ride, though. Dealing with emotion can be a test of one's testament in recovery. The real question that I need to ask is, how do you deal with being alone? How do you handle your anger and your fear? How do you handle guilt and disappointment? How do you cope with the emotion? It speaks to whether or not you have outgrown your confinement. The real question today is what happens when it is God and not satanic forces that put you behind a fence? I came to get somebody today. Okay, Moses was on the mountaintop approaching a burning bush until God put a fence up and said, don't take another step forward until you take off your shoes. So the question that you, if you're a critical thinker, would put in your mind and say, why would God tell him to take off his shoes when he's approaching the Heavenly Father? Moses did not realize really how dumb he was, y'all. What you mean, preacher? How you gonna call that man dumb? Because for 40 years, Moses had been running for killing somebody. Stay with me now. He was walking around wearing the same shoes that he had killed a man in. So he still got blood spatter on his shoes. I wish I had a forensic pathologist in the house. He still got sin, and he cannot bring sin into the presence of a God who knows no sin. So God said, I got to put a fence up. Take your shoes off, because you're walking on holy ground. I came to tell somebody every now and then, God got to put a fence up and tell you, take your shoes off. Take off the stuff that's been holding you back. Take off the stuff that's been holding you down. Okay, the Bible said, lay aside every weight that so easily besets you. You got to take some stuff off sometime when you get into the presence of the Lord. Because see, back then, you couldn't just go into church like you are now. Back then, there was different levels in the church. You know, there was the outer court, the inner court, and the Holy of Holies. So when you deal with sanctification, there are levels to this thing. And now God just does it on a spiritual level instead of on an earthly level. Your commitment level spoke of how close you wanted to get to God's glory. If you're comfortable being on the outer court, that's your business. If you're comfortable being in the inner court, that's your business. But if you want to get into the holies of holies, you got to render yourself unto the Lord. Look, a fence keeps stuff in, and a fence can keep stuff out. I came to tell you that in the start of this season, I told you last week it's going to be a new season for you. You got to get some stuff out of your system. Can I keep it real? Y'all might as well say it's rough in here. You got to get some people out your system going into your new season. You got to get some things off your mind going into your new season. You're not going to have to be able to take the same stuff that you had with you in your old season into your new season. Let me work my text. Job chapter 1, we found a man who was living upright. Evil is far from him. I wonder if this would be the year, by the end of 2023, that by the close of the year, you will be able to say here at New Mount Zion that I tried to live upright. This was the time that I tried to represent God the best that I could. This is the time that I didn't want evil attracted to me anymore. I wouldn't be seduced by my own flesh. I decided to keep evil people away from you. And God knows you can tell if you're in the spirit of God when evil is coming your way. I grew up in country town, old school, and all of us had that family members that you just knew you had to keep away from. Everybody had one in every family. So, Lord, keep evil thoughts away from me. It's an old song that we used to sing as a little boy. It said, Jesus be a fence all around me every day. So look, Job got 10 children. The order of structure is connected to the number 10. You got 10 fingers. You got 10 toes. Job got 10 children. It is reflective that his family has order. His family has structure and alignment. So in verse 5 of Job chapter 1, look at it when you get home. You will notice something that caught my attention. First of all, he sanctified his children. Point number one, you need to learn how to sanctify your children. What is sanctification, preacher? It just means set apart. There's nothing wrong with you setting your children apart from other folk. I told you, I grew up in the country, so when somebody wanted to, I got seven sisters, and somebody wanted to date one of my sisters, Reverend Russ, they had to come and talk to my daddy. Because my daddy wanted to know who your people were. So his daughter going to get hooked up with you. You're going to be sharing some of the same bloodline. So there's nothing wrong with talking to a mother, a father, about the people that your children are hanging with, because your children are set aside, that they're sanctified before God. You got to make a relationship. So if your relationship with God, your children ought to have a relationship with God because you train them up until they can learn for themselves. So I don't always need a fence around me, God, but put a fence around my children. I'm talking right now to some concerned parents who are worried about the welfare of your children. You want to see God cover every area of their life? And I'm talking to folk who got grown children. I know God cover my children. I know they don't do everything right, but God cover my children. I know they're doing some things that I used to do, and I knew it was wrong, but God cover my children. I came to find a keeping real people in the house on today. God cover my children. Cover what they possess. Cover what they're wearing. God cover my children. Put a fence around my children's relationships. I need to know who they're hanging out with, God. I need to know who's trying to date them, God. I need to know their habits, God. Lord, be a fence around my children. I wish I had some old school parents in the house that know that house belonged to you. When I was coming to you, better not lock no door in my daddy's house unless you were going to the bathroom for some privacy to do your business. You get mad and your father hollering at you and screaming at you, or your mother telling you what to do, you go and slam the door. My daddy would take the hinge off the door. And he didn't even have to whoop me because I was so scared because he busted the door down. But now it seems like our children are afraid of our parents. Our parents, are not afraid of our parents, but our parents seem to be afraid of them. But God, I need you to put a fence around my children. Hallelujah, God. I wish I had a parent in the house that want to be a real parent that said, I ain't taking this mess no more. Look, I am not my children's friend. I am their parent as long as they're in my house. You want me to be your friend? You graduate from college, get your own house, and I'll come visit you and be your friend. And then I start running your water. I start leaving your lights on. Then I'll be your friend. But until then, you are under my roof. You're going to do what I say, dude. If you don't like it, that's a problem with you, and you ain't gonna tell me how to run my household. God put a fence around my children. Why? Because the devil is after them. Got folk in there trying to label them with a learning deficiency.
God, put a fence around my children that they won't be on no medication. Lord, put a fence around my children that they won't have a nervous breakdown. I wish I had a parent in the house. God, build a fence around my children so they will not have to deal with drugs and alcohol. I know they legalize and stuff, but God, put a fence around my children so they will not bow down to peer pressure. God, put a fence around my children so they won't have to worry about abortions. God, put a fence around my children so they won't even think about committing suicide. God, put a fence around my children so they will not spend a night in jail. They will not harm themselves. No bullet will touch their body. God put a fence around my children. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Lord, put a fence around my children, because the truth of the matter is, school just started, but my children are under attack. And Satan, you better get your grimy hands off my child. God put a fence around my children. Hallelujah. And this is for parents that really want this. God, no more disrespect issues. Put a fence around my child. Guard their mouth. Open up their mouth. And when they try and speak something negative, only positive stuff will come out of their mouth. God, put a fence around my child. Change their attitude. Change their behavior. Change who they hang out with. Change their work ethic. Change their value. God, sanctify my children. Not only sanctify them, God, sanctify who they're going to get in contact with. Hallelujah. Because I want them to be a better daddy than I was, a better mama than I was. I wish I had a parent just speak your child's name out in the atmosphere. I want them to be a good grandparent one day. Devil, you cannot fight against God's children. I wish I had somebody that would help me shout, God, sanctify my children. Sanctify my grandchildren. God, help my children understand that they'll be able to speak in tongues. They'll be able to lay hands on the sick, and they will recover. God, sanctify my children. Can I get you a starter rumor real quick? To start this room, you can tweet it, send it down your road, you can text it, you can email it, put it on FaceTime or Facebook. Look, to tell somebody, my children are guilty of being sanctified. Church folk don't know when to shout. I'm trying to spread a rumor. You need to tell somebody, you can't mess with them if you ain't sanctified. My children are guilty of being sanctified. I wish I could speak it out into the atmosphere. Since you won't do it, I'll do it for you as the angel of this house. Our children are guilty of being sanctified. Our grandchildren are going to be guilty of being sanctified. As a matter of fact, we guilty of being sanctified. Lord, put a fence. We get to verse 7. And the roll is called. Anybody ever had homeroom? I know I got some teachers in the house. The roll is called for the sons of God. But here is the problem, y'all. Satan shows up in class as if he hasn't been expelled. No, he don't supposed to be on campus. He has no business coming to homeroom. God, help me up in here. This is getting ready to be the best shot I got for y'all in 2023. God said, if you give me glory, I just lock the door on people who don't belong in your life. Hallelujah! Glory to your name, God. God said, them folk that have been expelled, they ain't gonna get a key to come back into your presence. I can't hear nobody. It doesn't matter what they're trying to do. They cannot get back because the door has just been locked. So Satan, in his arrogance, he shows up with the sons of God. God does not talk to anybody else in the class but Satan. Why? Because he doesn't belong there. Evidence he hasn't seen him in a while. What you been doing? Satan says, I ain't been doing much. Just been chilling. Going to and fro. That's Ruff Theology 101. Trying to see who I can mess with. And the Lord does something that kind of bothered me at first. He makes a recommendation. Have you tried my servant Job? Satan, have you considered my servant Ruff? Satan reveals his innermost thoughts and says, as a matter of fact, I've been looking at him. But when I was thinking about trying to attack him, I realized that you had a fence around him. I wish I had a birdie sermon today. Only got this last point. Let me give you this. The argument preaches is that God opened the door for the fence. When the door was open, Satan stepped in. Satan destroyed his houses, started messing with his family, and messing with his money. Had a rough year. He had a rough day, and you fussing about a rough year. All this happened in one day, and you're talking about what you done lost, and we just in September. Job lost all of it in one day. As a matter of fact, he also got sick. He tried to get the vaccination, but it didn't work. Got balls and stuff all in one day. And to top it all off, his friends came to see him. Help me somebody. And instead of asking him how he was feeling, they went to accuse him. Job, what you do to make God do this to you? They didn't even realize that God had given Satan a permission slip. Can I get some help this morning? I wish you would just think about this in your own spirit. Thank you, Holy Ghost. What's amazing to me is that all of his children, Job provided a hedge fence around him. Just like if we had somebody down in the center and you stood around them, you would put a hedge fence of protection around them. Job was protecting his children. Job was protecting everything that he had because of the hedge fence of protection that was put around Job. Y'all gonna get it in a minute. Had nothing to do with what his children was doing. Had nothing to do with what the animals was doing. It had everything to do with what Job was doing because Job was making intercession for his children. He was sacrificing unto God, saying, just in case they didn't do it, God, and I know I taught them better, I'm going to do it. I wish I had some parents in the house that knew it's still okay to pray for your children when you go to bed at night. God, still watch over them. Just in case they ain't praying for themselves, God, I still want you to stand in the gap. So there's a hedge fence of protection around them. And all of a sudden, I don't believe God really removed it. I think God just lowered it down so that he could get to Job. He just lowered it down so that things could get to Job. Sickness can get to his body. He had told him that you can do anything but take his life. That's why I don't believe that he removed the hedge fence of protection. That he that's just my fear. I just think that he may have lowered it down that Satan would have an opportunity to get to him. But I'm so glad that even after he lowered it down, if you would read on all the things that Job went through, how people talked about him and how his wife even said, you ought to curse God and die. I believe that Job kept his faith in the Lord. Because I heard him when he said that the Lord giveth and the Lord taketh away. I feel all right now. I came to say blessed be the name of the Lord. And I believe because Job kept on his faith that he was going to trust in the Lord. And he knew that the only way to battle this thing is you got to plead the blood of God. Job didn't have Jesus, but I'm so glad that through 42 generations, according to Matthew, there was a lamb stricken from the foundation of the earth. He said, Father, make me a body, and I'll go down to redeem man back to you. You know who I'm talking about, don't you? He's Mary's baby. He's the lily of the valley. He's a bright and morning star. He's the Ancient of Days. Do you know him? Have you tried him? His name is Jesus, J-E-S-U-S. They hung him high, stretched him wide. He hung his head, and for you and me he died. But early one Sunday morning, he got up with all power in his hand, and that fence that had been lowered, God raised it back up again. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all sin is gone. I know who holds my future. Is there anybody here that knows Jesus? Ain't he all right? Won't he give you joy in the midst of your sorrow? Won't he make your enemies your footstools? Won't he do it? Won't he, won't he, won't he, won't he? Somebody ought to shout, yeah. Thank you, God, for sanctifying me. Thank you, God, for sanctifying my children. Thank you, God, for sanctifying my grandchildren and generation after generation. Thank the Lord, bless it from generation to generation. Won't he do it? Won't he do it? Won't he do it? I'm so glad. I got a God that, even when the fence is lowered, cancer may come, eviction may come, bankruptcy may come. I don't think you're immune to things because you say it. Addiction will come, brokenheartedness may come, phony friends will come. But I'm so glad that I got a God that can lift the fence back up. And he ain't got to go get no certificate from the city. He don't need permission from nobody. He can say, my child who was going through. And sometimes we go through. Ooh, thank you, Holy Ghost. So God can show us off. Sometimes God wants us to be his showpiece. Because how can you tell somebody what God can do if you ain't ever been through it? I don't want to be around no church folk that ain't never cried. I don't want to be around no church folk that ain't never been through nothing. Because if you ain't never been through nothing, how you going to tell me how to get through what I've been through? I know that some folk, if God ain't never did, you ain't never had to go through nothing, you ought to thank God that he had his hands on you and nothing ever happened to you. But here is an example of a man who followed after God's own heart. A man that shunned evil, was upright, and still had to go through. But if you read in the end, he got double for his trouble. I don't know how old Job was. Lord, keep my mind clear for a little while. But he had 10 children. He ended up with 20. Let's stand all over the church. God gave him all his power back. Because he was on his deathbed. I don't know about you, if you ever been sick, you don't want to talk to nobody but God. That sometimes you be so sick, you don't even want nobody around you to touch you. But God is good. Restored him. And that's what I'm looking for God to do for us. As he's a fence all around us every day. Maybe there's one on today. You've been asking God to tell you why you're going through the things you're going through. Sometimes God may say, have you tried my servant? Have you checked out what Daphne's doing? Have you checked out what Russell is doing? Have you checked out the Pattersons? Have you checked out any other members in New Mazan? Have you looked at Aunt Helen's life? Try her and watch her come through. And she'll be able to tell you that I've been young, but now I'm old. But I've never seen the righteous forsaken. All the days of my life, he's provided for me. He's taken care of me. And though my steps may not be as fast as they used to be, I'm still stepping. Hey, glory! So I declare, if you put that faith in the God that she knows, put that faith in the God that has kept New Mount Zion for over 100 plus years. He'll clean you up, fix you up, set you on a street called straight. I'm not going to sit and tell you ain't going to have no problems, but the difference is, as you got God with you, he said, I'll handle the problems. And when you can't walk, I'll carry you. When you can't handle them, I'll handle them. So we pray that there's one on today that will give your life over to the Lord. Receive him for who he is and for all that he's able to do for you.
We pray that if someone knows him and left him, that wherever you are, you would find your way back to him. Because there's no God like our God. There's no God like Jehovah. Thank you, God, for saving souls on today. Thank you, God, for blessing hearts on today. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. We thank God. Just a few quick announcements. We had a great district conference. It was spirit-filled. Day and a half, we had a glorious time. We have some items coming up. You know, next Sunday is going to be our Family and Friends Day. We pray that you would be willing to invite family and friends out so we can pack the house. Ask those who are family and friends to be a blessing and sow $10 into you, and that you can at least give a $100 offering on that day. If you can get 10 people to sow, if you got 20 friends, get them to sow $5. Amen, somebody. How can I break it another down? You got 50 friends, get them to sow $2. I know a little bit. They taught me a little math in school. Amen, somebody. But the truth of the matter is, we just want to be a blessing to the house. This is one of our major days, and we pray that you will be a blessing. We know September 23rd at 11 a.m., please put it on your calendar. We have our virtual second quarterly conference. That's September the 23rd. And then we get to move to the month of October. On the 15th, we will be going to Mount Nemo NRZU Church, where Reverend Brooks is the pastor, to do a service for him at 3 o'clock. And then our fall revival starts in October 18th. First Baptist Bolingbrook and their choir and pastor will be here Thursday night, Mount Zion, Virginia Beach. Their pastor and choir will be here, and Friday night, St. John, Norfolk will be our guest, starting at 7 p.m. nightly. And then on October 21st is St. John's Men's Day Breakfast. And then we ask them to come and share with us our Men's Day on October 22nd, which will be at our 10 a.m. worship service. October 22nd. So we're looking for a good time these next few weeks. God is going to bless us. And I declare, I won't take a whole lot of preaching engagement, so the few that I take, please come with me. Amen. Amen. We're not going to be running all over the place, because I told y'all, y'all see what I got on. I like to sit down and relax too. Amen, somebody. When I was much younger, I'd run everywhere. But Patterson, you need to tell me, as you get older, the knees let you know. Sometimes you got to sit down. Amen, amen. But we thank God for all that he's done. And if you still want to join us every Sunday, we're here in person at 10 a.m. 10 a.m. every Sunday, 10 a.m. 113 Sequel Street here in the Bolingbrook section of Norfolk, Virginia, 23505. You can catch us on Zoom, 587-003-8164. We thank God for all of your support, for all that you do. And if you are not going to be here, please, if you're watching us on Zoom or listening to us any other way, or see us on Facebook, please share and sow into this church. And we declare God will bless you for all that you do. Amen? Amen. We thank God. Our altar call, we ask that you will continue to lift up those who are dealing with things, that you will continue to lift them up in prayer, that God will continue to strengthen and keep them, and that everything will work out on their behalf. Because we know that God is a healer. We know that God is able to deliver. And we know that God is a provider. Amen. God, we pray now for those who are dealing with any type of sickness, physical, spiritual, or mental. God, we claim victory in every area of their lives. We ask that you, Holy Spirit, will come in and sup with them and move in them and dwell in them, so that everything can be made perfect in you, so that they will glorify you and they will be a witness for you. We count it done. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. We thank God for you. May you stand in God's house. Kickoff is at 1 o'clock. You got time to go home and get your stuff together, whatever it's going to be. And don't be surprised one day your pastor call you and say, can I come eat and indulge in the glory of God with you. Amen, amen. We just want you to enjoy life. Church life is short. Solomon said it's like a vapor. Here today, gone tomorrow. Enjoy every area of your life. Don't let anybody tell you. He said, I came that you might have life and have it more abundantly. Enjoy yourself. You know when going too far is too far. We're old enough to understand that. But enjoy life. Don't let life pass you by. And you look back and say, I wish I, what, shoulda, woulda, coulda? What the fuck you say, shoulda, woulda, coulda? Amen. Amen. Eternal God, we thank you. We thank you for reminding us that you should be the fence around us. We put fences around everything. We deal with fences every day. But God, thank you for reminding us that you are a fence, a hedge fence of protection around us and our children and our grandchildren and generations to come. Not only that, God, be a fence around our families, whether they are extended, those who just come to be a part of us. We thank you for blessing the New Mount Zion family. Continue to watch over us and keep us until we come together again. Now may the grace of God, the sweet communion of his Holy Spirit, rest, rule, and abide with us henceforth and forevermore. And all of God's children said, amen, 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 amen. God bless you.